نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. I welcome all the viewers of Peace TV with the greetings of peace. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله. We have been learning an important lesson in this series titled Trials and Tribulations along with our beloved Sheikh, Sheikh Suleiman Salim from USA. الحمد لله, in the past episodes, we learned about many ways how should a believer, how should a Muslim overcome the trials and tribulations of this world? And it can be a source of benefit for him, not just in the negative sense, but it has lots of positivity to it as well. In this episode, inshallah, we will be discussing with the Sheikh about the greatest trials. We know there are trials in this world and we cannot just let it go. It is a part and parcel of our life. But there are certain trials which Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam had specified, separated it from the other trials. And this is what our discussion is going to be today with Sheikh Suleiman Salim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, as I said, that Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam has specified in the sunnah that there are certain trials and tribulations which are greater than the others. And I remember one such hadith from Sahih al-Bukhari, wherein Umar radiallahu anhu happened to ask the Sahaba in a gathering that, can anyone narrate to me of a hadith which talks about the fitan? And the Sahaba told him, informed him about the fitna of the family that which one faces, his wife, his children, and the other things. So Umar radiallahu anhu said, no, I'm not talking about the fitnas of the family and the children and the wealth that which one faces. I'm talking about the greater fitnas. The greater fitan. So Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, one of those who was present in that gathering, radiallahu anhum, he said that, O Amirul Mu'mineen, between those greater fitnas and us, there is a door. So Umar radiallahu anhu said, will that door be open or will it be broken? So Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman replied, that door would be broken and never to be closed. And Umar radiallahu anhu left that gathering. And when the other students who were seated in that gathering, they asked Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, what was that door, that which is between us and the other fitan? So Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu said that it is Umar himself. So they asked, does Umar know about it? He said, Umar knows better than me, that he is the door. So from this hadith, we understand that there are certain greater fitnas. So what these greater fitnas are and how should we take our precautions? Because we know, even in sins, there are certain sins which are minor sins. And there are certain sins that which are major sins. And we have to be more cautious about them. Similarly, there are certain fitnas that which are minor in nature, which everyone should undergo. But there are other fitnas that which are major. So just list to us what those fitnas are and what precautions can we take as Muslims in this worldly life. Jazakallahu khair.
Barakallahu feek. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Now, as you mentioned, there are different degrees of these fitan, these trials and these tribulations that go about. And so one of these fitan is the one that was mentioned in Tafsir al-Qurtubi, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, whoever is afflicted with a calamity, then let him remember the greatest calamity, the greatest fitna, and that is my death. And so when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, this was a true tribulation for the ummah. A true test, not just for those who were alive at that time, but even for us. In what context? So first, the people that were alive at the time, what did they go through? Those who were with the Prophet ﷺ from the beginning. Imagine after years and years and years of harassment and abuse and persecution. Imagine after they attached themselves to Rasulullah ﷺ and they truly loved the Prophet ﷺ. And we spoke previously about loving the Messenger ﷺ. Now imagine they loved him this much, more than even themselves and their families and their wealth. And this is how it's supposed to be. This is what we're commanded to do. Now imagine you love someone so much, such as the Prophet ﷺ, who is so amazing. And he is so appealing. People love to be around him. He makes you feel happy, makes you feel good about yourself. This is Rasulullah ﷺ. So when they found out that the Prophet ﷺ was ill, they became a little worried. And so over time, the illness increased. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as he became ill, the Sahaba started noticing that he could no longer come out to pray. And he would ask, request for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to lead the prayer. And this is one of the indications of Abu Bakr's status in Islam and the indication that he should be leading next in the ummah. And so Abu Bakr would lead the prayer, and sometimes the Prophet ﷺ would open the curtain and they would see him in salah and they would almost break their salah. They would be so happy. And this is the Prophet ﷺ. They loved him. And so they would almost break their salah for him, and then he would indicate, keep praying, keep praying. So they continued to pray. And as the days went on, the Prophet ﷺ's illness, it increased. And as it increased, he could no longer come out to the prayer anymore. He could no longer lead anymore, to the point where Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he led more than 19 prayers. According to other scholars, it was more than double the amount. He led all of those consecutive prayers. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his illness, now they're coming to him to visit him, and he's always reminding them about the things that they need to be doing. And one of those reminders that I do want to mention is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, imagine on his deathbed, after he had conveyed the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after he had told the companions that one of your servants, one of the servants of Allah, was given a decision. He was given a decision between this dunya, living in this world, and between returning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that servant chose Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abu Bakr began to cry. He began to cry because he understood the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was speaking about himself. And it was building up to his death. And with Surah Al-Nasr, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ, when that was revealed, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam conveyed it to them, they started to listen, and Abu Bakr started to cry because he knew what it meant. He knew what it meant. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. And you see, after the victory, you see the people coming into the faith of Allah. They're coming in and accepting the message of Allah through His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in crowds. أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. So glorify your Lord and seek forgiveness from your Lord. إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who accepts the repentance. Now the companions, they said, when they heard this, and they saw Abu Bakr crying, they asked, what's wrong with Abu Bakr? Why is he crying? Abu Bakr knew with his faith and his knowledge, radiallahu anhu. And we ask Allah to allow us to meet Abu Bakr in paradise.
Ameen.
So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he understood, and that is why he cried. And then days later, the other Sahaba, they caught on. Oh, this is why Abu Bakr was crying. They understood. And they said, it was the narrator that one of them said, and we realized then how great Abu Bakr was, how much knowledge he had, how much more faith he had than us, how superior he was than us. Now all of these things are building up to that big fitna. All of these are building up to that big fitna. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he becomes more ill and more ill. And then to the point where he's saying, as-salah, as-salah, reminding us, as-salah, take care of your prayer, take care of your prayer. Imagine he has 23 years to convey the message. And in all of those years, he conveyed so many good things that we should do. And one of the last things he reminds us about is as-salah, as-salah. So as-salah, as-salah, take the final advice of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is passing away, he's asking for al-Rafiq al-A'la, for the higher companion, the higher status. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in this moment, in this position where he's sweating and he's going through pain, and he's waking up and walking and he's becoming unconscious and falling. And he collapses and wakes up and has someone wash him, and he wakes up again and tries to stand and he falls again. He's too sick, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so Abu Bakr hears that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam might be actually improving in his health. And so he sets out back to his house. When he arrives at his house, someone comes to him and tells him, go back because we heard the Prophet ﷺ passed away and the people need you. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he goes back straight to the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ. He walks into the masjid and the people are in panic. The people there are in shock. And he goes back to this house of the Prophet ﷺ, to the Hijr, and he goes to Aisha radiallahu anha's house, and he goes inside and he comes to the Prophet ﷺ's body and it's covered. And he lifts the cover off of his face, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he kisses him on the forehead. May my mother and father be ransomed for you, Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now Abu Bakr knew at this moment, this was the test. This is the fitna, that very moment. And this is why Abu Bakr was needed at that moment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for someone as great as Abu Bakr to be utilized at that moment. Because the rest of the ummah needed him. The rest of the ummah needed Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu at that moment. And so when he comes out, he realizes there's a responsibility on his shoulders. Radiallahu anhu, he knows what must be done during this fitna. And so Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he comes out and he sees the people in panic. And they're screaming and they're crying and they're in terror and they're in shock and they're in sadness and grief. And they're torn because the Rasulullah, their beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is gone. This is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one that they loved, the one that they would sacrifice their lives for. And so when Abu Bakr comes out and the people are in panic, Umar radiallahu anhu is standing there. And he's holding his sword. And he's saying, whoever says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away, I will cut off his head. I will kill him. This is Umar radiallahu anhu. We know the status of Umar in Islam. We don't even need to begin. Umar radiallahu anhu is one of the greatest people in Islam. One of the greatest people to walk this earth. Al-Faruq. He changed the ummah in the years that he ruled the ummah. And by Allah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to meet Umar radiallahu anhu in Jannah. At that moment though, this is the indication of how great the fitna was. That even Umar could not handle it at that time. Meaning Umar radiallahu anhu, along with the other sahaba. Umar was saying, whoever says the Prophet ﷺ has passed away has lied. He has gone to his Lord. He has gone to his Lord to speak to Allah as Musa alayhi salam went to speak to his Lord for 40 nights. And so Umar refused to accept that the Prophet ﷺ had passed away. Meaning the fitna was so great, it shook them. It shook their faith. Imagine. And this is what a fitna does. It tests a person. And so at that moment, they needed Abu Bakr without even realizing it. And Allah knew that they needed Abu Bakr. And Allah had prepared Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu when he was close to the Prophet ﷺ, when he traveled with the Prophet ﷺ, when he went to the cave with the Prophet ﷺ, and he said, لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. This is the good companion, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from those who are evil and those who say anything otherwise about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So as Abu Bakr comes out, Umar is saying this, he tries to move Umar. Sit down, Umar, let me talk. Umar refuses, he's too angry. This fitna has shaken him. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he goes to the minbar of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he says, oh people, ayyuhan nas, man kana ya'budu Muhammadan fa inna Muhammadan qad mat. Wa man kana ya'budu Allah fa inna Allah hayyun la yamut. Oh people, whoever worship Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then know that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam has passed away. And whoever worshipped Allah, then know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever living and does not die. And so Abu Bakr said this, and then he recited the ayah from Surah Ali Imran. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلِ. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is nothing but a messenger like the messengers before him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if he dies, are you going to flip on your ankles? Meaning, are you going to go into chaos and disarray and disbelief? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding them. Umar ibn Khattab said, it was as if at that moment he had heard the ayah for the first time in his life. Despite the fact that he knew the ayah. Abu Bakr, they knew his status. This was the honor of Abu Bakr and the faith of Abu Bakr that allowed him to help the ummah at a time when the fitna was so great.
Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. We realize the importance and the greatest fitna that which occurred to the Muslim ummah was the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we will continue discussing on this inshallah, but after a break. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back after the break. Shaykh, alhamdulillah, before the break, we were discussing about the greatest trial from among the other trials that which a person faces in this world. And you said from among the greatest trials was the trial of the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We want to know what is the biggest loss that which occurred after the death of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it became a trial for the entire ummah, as you said, till the present day.
Barakallahu fiqh. By Allah, this is one of the most moving parts of reading the seerah, the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when you read about the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you see how the Sahaba reacted. You see how much they loved him. All of Medina was crying. Everyone was shaken. People came in crowds and they were praying janazah for many days. They tried to come to the little hijr, the room of Aisha radiallahu anha, to pray janazah upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they came day after day after day. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so important to them and important to this ummah. He was the one that conveyed the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, the Sahaba, although they lost someone beloved to them, they also realized that this would affect the rest of the ummah. This is a fitna for everyone in this ummah later on as well, including us. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had said, shortly before that, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ, this was the end of it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is passing, that's it, the revelation is over. Now Jibreel alayhi wa sallam is not going to come to someone else and give them this revelation. He was the last messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, the revelation ended. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's revelation ends, when he no longer can convey to us, we no longer have the ability to ask. We no longer have the ability to have more. We no longer have that connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there's a very important point I do want to make here for the sake of knowledge and for amana, is that this does not mean that we can go to Rasulullah and ask for help. This does not mean we can go to him and pray to him, you know, you are our connection to Allah, so help us. Rather, what we are saying is that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he was a messenger, the revelation came through him. And so when the revelation ceases, that's it. We can no longer connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, meaning we no longer have news from Allah. We no longer have new information coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the Qur'an is complete. The Qur'an is complete. And the last verse that was revealed was approximately, according to some scholars, 7 days before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, verse 281 of Surah Al-Baqarah. وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ And fear the day in which you shall return back to Allah. ثُمَّ تُوَفَّى كُلُّ نَفْسٍ مَا كَسَبَتْ وَهُمْ لَا يُظْلَمُونَ And every soul shall be given what it deserved, what it earned, and nobody will be dealt with unjustly or with injustice. This was the last verse to be revealed from the heavens, the last verse of the Qur'an to be revealed. And so the Prophet ﷺ, when he passed away and he could no longer convey this to us, this is the last thing that we have. This is the Qur'an and it is complete. This is Islam and it is complete. This is the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and it is complete. So this fitna affected the companions and those who were alive at the time and affected those afterwards in that there is no more revelation. There's no more news, there's no more change, there's no more additions, there's no more anything at all related to the faith. It is complete. Furthermore, we can no longer meet the Prophet ﷺ. We can no longer go to him and speak to him. And truly, if we could, we would give up everything to go, even for a moment. If we could at this very moment give up everything around us in this dunya, all of our wealth, all of our family, sacrifice all that we know, to go and see the Prophet ﷺ in real life for a moment, we would do it. And this is what the believers would do because of their love for Rasulullah
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Now, this fitna, although is a huge, huge fitna, there were also some other fitnas after that. There were many fitnas after that.
Besides the greatest fitna that which we have already spoken about, there were some other fitnas that which Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had alluded to in his sunnah. Like for example, he had said that the nations that which came before you were destroyed because of this fitna, the fitna of the women folk. And I fear that even you would be destroyed by this fitna. So could you please explain that hadith to the audience, that how can one of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the creation that which has been created for complimenting us, how can that become a source of fitna?
Barakallahu feek. The reason I laugh, and I'm sure you understand, is that many people, especially those who are trying with their ignorance to attack Islam, they will take this hadith in the wrong way. And so it is kind of funny at how low they will stoop in their ignorance to use this hadith in the wrong way. So some of them will say, well, look, you're treating women as if they are a trial for you. What kind of, you know, treatment of women is that? When in fact, if they knew anything about Islam, women are honored in Islam. Women are, their status is so high in Islam. Your mother beneath her feet is paradise, as we mentioned before. So when you talk about women as a temptation, we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who created us, knows what is desired by humans, knows what we desire. And so even in Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ It has been made for people the desires of what? The desires and the love of what? حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ To the end of the ayah. So Allah is saying one of the things that people have been attached to, it has been created as a desire for them, is the woman. So women are a desire. And this is not a bad thing. This is not an insult. Rather, this is something that shows us Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates us in different ways. And so everyone treats things differently. And everyone has different desires and attachments and passions. And so when we talk about this fitna, when we talk about women as a fitna, rather, it's referring to the fact that women can be used and they can be a source of fitna if they are not following certain guidelines. And this is not referring to guidelines within only a family. Rather, it's referring to all of society. Now, the scariest and saddest thing that we have in our day and age that proves this hadith is true is the industry of pornography and adult entertainment. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ Now, this industry, sadly, it's not a small thing. It's a huge part of the industry. It's a huge business. And so this industry is so large. And so the fitna is magnified. Why? Because now we don't only have print and papers and magazines. Now we have the internet and we have pictures and we have videos. And so now this fitna has magnified. So the way that technology works and affects the things that we have in this world, both good and bad, is that it magnifies them. So social media and the internet, it can magnify the good that you can do and it can magnify the evil that you can do. And so this fitna of the woman, the fitna of creating an industry out of it, you can see now that this is true and that this was fulfilled as a prophecy. And so many people succumb to it. Many people fall to this fitna because it is everywhere and because it has become magnified through the media and through the internet and through other forms of technology. And now there are entire adult entertainment and there are movies with certain ratings and classification. And there are even in marketing, they teach people to use women in some societies as a form of advertising because it's appealing to the product. So they'll use women who are attractive and they'll make it in a certain way, entice people in a certain way to bring them to that product. And this is very common. And so people fall to this fitna all the time. And this is a very dangerous fitna. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا, do not approach fornication or adultery, He's saying do not approach, not just do not do it. So even the steps that lead to it are haram. So if you know that you're going down this path of haram, you have to cut it off from its roots. And so all of these things that we see around us in society, which is extremely sad, they are immoral. So for example, in the West, we have a huge industry with pornography and adult entertainment. And yet society now accepts it. It's normal. And this is a sign of the Day of Judgment. It's a huge fitna that people will find fornication normal and adultery and all of these things are normal. And so pornography has become normal. Adult entertainment is normal. People don't find it as a big deal anymore. And that is where the problem lies, that people no longer stand up to it as something immoral. And as Muslims, we should always have these guidelines because they are not just for us. It's not just me and Allah and you and Allah. Rather, it's me and my family and my society, my entire nation. Whether it's America or India or anywhere else around the world, wherever you are living, it's about the goodness in that society, the morality and the preservation of that society. So this issue of pornography and adult entertainment is a huge problem and a huge fitna, and it affects many people. And so this is one of the fitna that the Prophet ﷺ had spoken about. Another of the fitna the Prophet ﷺ spoke about is regarding money and wealth. So al-mal wal-banuna zinatul hayat al-dunya.
This would be the third, inshallah.
Yes, the third, inshallah. Barakallahu fi. So this other type of fitna is the fitna of wealth and children, and especially wealth and consumerism. And in our day and age, again, it is magnified, subhanAllah. Now, the beautiful thing is, and I really want to emphasize this, a lot of people, they will look around at our day and age and they'll say, wow, the fitna is so widespread, more than in the past. Because without a doubt, we have more access to fitna in our day and age, more than the Sahaba. Meaning we can access all of the haram things only with a smartphone and internet. That is how bad the fitna has gotten. And when you think about it, some people will look pessimistically at this and say, the fitna is so great in our day and age, so much evil, so many ways of getting sayyat, so many ways of getting sins. And yet you don't look at the other side, which is that if there are so many ways to get sins in your day and age, in your year, wherever you're living, that means there are also more ways to get hasanat when you abstain from the sins. So subhanAllah, you have to look at both sides of it. And so the more this fitna spreads of wealth and beauty and women and children, the more we have to return ourselves back to the core, back to Islam, the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah, because that is where morality is found and goodness is found and attachment to Allah is found and attachment to preparing to meet Allah is found. So when we detach ourselves from the dunya, when we stay away from the materialism of this dunya, when we stop competing only to have more wealth, al-haakum al-takathur, more wealth and rivalry in this world, and then we will remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابَةِ. We will race with one another in this dunya and compete for one another until when? Until you die, until you go to the graveyards. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from these different fitan.
Jazakallahu khairan, Shaykh. And we too pray to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala keeps us safe and sound from these greater fitnas that which have been spoken about in this episode. Inshallah, we will continue speaking upon more of such greater fitnas in the coming episodes. Until then, I take your leave. Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.